I think that everybody, when they're a kid, has people that they look up to. They have their idols. For me, in baseball, it was Lance Parrish, who is like a god. He was the biggest guy. He had the orange gloves, so I'd spray paint my glove orange for that. But in hockey, it was Rick Tocchet. And Rick Tocchet, at the time, was a power forward captain for the Philadelphia Flyers, could fight, could score, and could win championships. And that's who I wanted to be.
Hi, I'm Kurt David, joined by our guest, Darren McCarty. Darren, great to have you on
the
show.
Thank you, Kurt. Great to be here.
So, Darren, born in British Columbia, raised in Leamington, Ontario. Can you help us connect the dots between Leamington and four Stanley Cups? How do you connect those dots?
Let's just say, give or take 5-10 minutes for the border, the house I grew up in is 40 minutes from Joe Louis Arena. So, pretty much, I am as close, if not closer, than most of the suburbs or where the people from that are Detroit fans, either go back when I grew up to Tiger Stadium, Joe Louis Arena, Pontiac Silverdome.
It was all there for you.
You know, it was. I grew up a huge Tiger fan, and obviously a Wings fan too, because I was the only one that rooted in my town. And during the 80s, when it was the Dead Wings time, the thing that we had like was that Yzerman came in, and then Proby and Joey and the fights and all that stuff. So I actually have been to Olympia. When I was 5 years old, I sat behind a pole watching one of the guys from my hometown, Kurt Bowman, play for Chicago, so my dad took me. And then, obviously, Joe Louis Arena. And then to be drafted and by the hometown kid and to be able to make it.
It was like playing at home again.
Well, it just was, just being so familiar and, you know, with sports, not only with hockey, with baseball and with everything.
Yeah, in fact, before hockey, you were big time into baseball, right? That was your first love, more or less, and you had three provisional championships. In other words, you won three state championships, is what we call them.
Yeah, exactly.
What position? What position?
I was a catcher.
Okay.
I had the arm, couldn't hit a curveball, and was better off smacking guys, so I decided that hockey was the better way to go. The only way I would trade is to give me the same career.
Ah, yes, you know? good point. But the physicality of hockey appealed to you more.
You know, I was good. I was always good at hockey, but I was always the knock against me was always, were you going to be good enough skater to be able to play? I could. Yeah. I thought the game well, and so I worked my butt off.
Well, it worked out for you because obviously hockey became huge for you. I mean, four Stanley Cups. How do you connect those dots between Leamington and the four Stanley Cups, playing professional hockey, playing for the Red Wings?
When you say that, the first word that comes to mind is family. You look at not only what they brought to the hockey community, but to the Tigers, to the city, to, you know, Mrs. Illich with the casino.
What they mean
the
to
Fox,
you personally.
You know, yeah, and always treated, I know myself, like another one of the kids.
Like and the family.
Yeah, like family. Like when good, bad, or indifferent. I mean, all my ups and downs have been public, and they were there along the way for
supporting you.
Right, which enabled me to get, you know, with a lot of help from a lot of people, get to where I am today. Mm-hmm. You know what? Things don't always go well. You're going to have bumps in the road. You're going to have arguments. But it's family. You find a way to work it out.
So it was like an extended family to you.
Absolutely.
And that's what made you so comfortable and excel, you think?
Still is. Not only putting the best team together, but you know what? Like, that's what you say about Scotty Bowman. He wasn't probably the greatest coach, X's and O's, that you would know, but he was the greatest psychologist. Well, he pretty much knew that, and at the time, he pretty much left me alone, you know, because he knew
you would take care of
him. He knew what I would bring to the table.
Every time.
So sometimes maybe he would, a few times at practice, maybe I smelled really bad or something that he would overlook.
Say something.
Winning hides a lot of stuff.
And so you talked about the pivotal moment, and that was Lemieux, Claude Lemieux. That square off with him, they say that changed the direction of the team, right?
Well, no, it was that Lemieux was on the ice, foot grabs me, but Shanny busts his arms off me, so I pop out of the pile, and I look at him, and I tell everybody, I said, that's not a sucker punch. That's a cold cock. When you look at somebody in the face and you blast, that's a cold cock. Mm-hmm. I cold cocked that MF as hard as I could. And
how do you think that changed the team at that moment?
Well, not because of that. Hence, I got 4 minutes and 10, came out, fought the next period. The big thing is we took an overtime. I scored the overtime winner because we hadn't beat them. after the year before they beat us out in the conference finals.
It's like a curse up to that
point. We'd set the league record 62 wins. Mm-hmm. They'd beat us all out of the playoffs mm-hmm. and all three times. So not only did we slay the dragon, we kicked the living snot out of the dragon. Mm-hmm.
Well, at some point, all pro athletes are done. Right. Yeah. At some point, and unfortunately for you, it came in 2009 where the career was over. And at what point did you realize it was over? What helped you understand, boy, I'm done?
Oh, body was done.
It
was after the run in 08 and hang on for 09 and just it was enough. I was happy to have been
at
able
08,
to have yeah. that comeback and be able to win a cup. And then unfortunately, we lost in 07 and 09. And that was it. You know, I proved my point to myself, mm-hmm. which was the comeback was for me,
yeah.
just to because I knew I had one last gas in me, and I felt that not only that, just being around and the presence could help either on the bench or in the dressing room, and that was true. And then it was time to move on, and you know, it was. You know, it was a weird time. I wasn't missing the game. It just
you were ready emotionally at that point.
Oh, I was ready
physically.
Bunch of years before, probably right. when I got released in 04 and went to Calgary. After that first year, the second
you
year
you started thinking about it.
Well, it just didn't have the same.
Mm-hmm.
It was different. I've had to leave out of this area.
Mm-hmm.
I went away to Clearwater, Florida, mm-hmm. to write my book. That was very therapeutic for me and helping me. And at the point when I wrote it in 13 and 14, I was off the pills and off the hard stuff. I'd started to get more serious into the medical marijuana, even though I did smoke, but getting into my body and stuff like that. I have to have my own program. Mm-hmm. That's what they preach. And my program involves medical marijuana because it doesn't lead me anywhere else. And for me, I'm the only difference between me and you out there is I had a cool job. What I did.
Four Stanley Cups.
Great, all that. But what I did is not who I am. And more so now, I've been able to
identify that,
find myself.
What do you think helped you in your transition? Because you had addictions, you had, you know, we
divorces,
talked about divorces and bankruptcies,
gambling. I've never been arrested. Those are all white collar.
Yeah, so that transition. I mean, you from four Stanley Cups to that, but now things are different for you. And what do you think helped with that transition, that life? I mean, first of all, emotionally, you knew you were done with hockey, right? You said that earlier.
Yeah, oh, yeah. Everybody says you missed the game, and I still do a lot. Like, for 2-3 years, I want nothing to do mm-hmm. with it. Until those alumni games started mm-hmm. to come along, and even I probably medically shouldn't have played in those alumni, the first couple anyways, just because I was not in
your name. I mean, Darren McCarty, right?
No, but I had no interest other than being around the guys.
Yeah, hanging out
with
the guys.
That's it. You miss everything about the game.
That's the part you miss the most.
But playing.
Yeah, you miss.
You don't miss playing.
Now, what's Darren McCarty doing now?
Well, I got one thing. Okay, so I'm not a big social media guy, right? Mm-hmm. But something came to my attention through some friends of mine of this fan creator. Mm-hmm. So pretty much it's a one-on-one.
Mm-hmm.
To direct fans, because you know I'm not a big into like all the trolling and stuff like that or whatever. But if somebody, and I call them forever fans. So if you've been through with me through thick and thin and want to get the daily of what I do and how I do it, and mm-hmm. you know, from thoughts to pictures to videos,
the personal insight,
it's one on one. It's you know, it's like a $10 subscription a mm-hmm. month, and I'll give you daily stuff on just, you know, what goes through my head every day. And this sort of has sort of helped into being the director and the producer. And there's so many different ideas that I have with this, you know, along with the working in progress of doing a podcast.
Yeah, is any of that live now? Is the fan experience, is that
the
live?
Fancreator.com.
How do people access that?
They go to dmac.fancreator.com, dmac.fancreator.com, mm-hmm. that's C-R-A-T-E-R. Mm-hmm. And you can look on Darren McCarty Official on my Facebook, because I did set up official Facebook.
You broke down.
Well, I set it up, but I'm not communicating through it.
Okay.
I will post a few little
right.
things, but if you,
you
want
to be a member to communicate.
Yeah, if you want to, and I will respond to you. I and it's cool. We've had it going for a few weeks now, and going through few of the bugs, but it's good.
That's great. Every pro athlete has a transition. We know 100% of professional athletes ultimately lose their job, right, at some point. But we want this show to be more than just about transition of professional athletes. We want it to be about transitions in life. And so what advice would you have for anybody that's facing a change or transition in life? What advice would Darren McCarty have?
Well, you know, this is one that I thought about, and this is really, really true. Before you do anything, your credit is the most important in today's society. If you don't have credit.
What do you mean by that?
I mean, credit your, you know, what is it, 750 or whatever, on your, you know, credit
card. Oh, like
karma,
our bank credit score.
Your credit right. score.
Well, Darren, I appreciate your advice and appreciate you being on the show. This wraps up another show. I'd like to thank Renaissance Village of Detroit for hosting us. Please join us again next time when we watch the stories of professional athletes unfold from glory days.